I'm Suzan-Lori Parks. We are going to do what we do every week here in the lobby of the public theater and with folks who watch us online streaming, which is cool that you're watching us. We're going to work for, today we're going to only work for 40 minutes because we're starting to work late. So we're going to work for 14 minutes for zero, and then we will do some conversation about your work and your creative process. And for those of you who don't know, this is a play. And the first thing we do is create the action together by working, and then we create the dialogue together by talking. I know, it's so easy. I wish all playwriting was that simple. So Patty is going to tell us, if you guys are online and want to tweet us a question, Patty will tell us how to do that.
You can tweet your questions to @watchmework, SLP, with the hashtag new play.
@watchmework, SLP, hashtag new play. Great. Okay, so Patty is going to set her timer for us, and we'll all get some work done, and hopefully my phone won't ring, or maybe it will.
By my checking account going negative every time a rent check clears.
It
interferes with sleep and my creative process. Very distracting.
What is very distracting?
The constant worry about money.
Right. So Karen's got a really good question. How do I keep writing? How do I keep my creative thing going while keeping my bills paid and being responsible to it?
And I'm not talking about extravagant living at all.
Like I said, I mean, I did say this last week, and I'll say the same thing again, that you find time to do your work.
Yeah, understood. That's not my problem.
Okay.
Like, I work on the train, I work into the wee hours of the night on my creative stuff.
Okay.
Right? But my cell phone gets turned off, cable gets turned off. I mean, and I'm working as much as I can without it interfering with this, which is of the utmost importance. I'm wearing shoes to one of my jobs that are, they're falling apart.
Right, right.
Because I don't, because I really live less than paycheck to paycheck.
Well, that goes into like a personal area. You know, either you can choose different jobs. I mean, it's all about choices. Every single thing we do as adults, and it's kids too, but as adults, really, you come face to face with choices. You know, things you want to do, things you can do, and things you can afford to do. And if you have a situation now where you're working your jobs and you're having time to do your writing, that's good, that sounds good, but it sounds like your jobs, or your several jobs, which aren't quite making everything meet up together, are producing a lot of worry and concern. And I would say then maybe you need to get some different jobs. Because it sounds like you've really figured out how to have a day job and do your work, which is major, okay? But your day job isn't providing you with your rent money, okay? So I think you need to get a different day job. I mean, you know, I think that's what it is. I think you need to get a different day job. Or, you know, you might look at getting a day job, in addition to, or whatever, issue. I mean, that's kind of what it is. And we all do that. I mean, I teach at NYU and Yale. Not because I like to ride the train from New Haven. Although the train in New Haven is nice. I have a new train. Anybody's ridden up to New Haven lately? They have a new, not a new train, but a new car. You know, those new cars you can plug in your stuff, which is really kind of swanky, you know?
Are they double level?
They're not double level, but they're just, they have to clean and bright and, yeah, they're nice, but that's not why I took a job. So we all make choices, and we all just say, okay, this is what I'm doing right now, or this is what I'll do for a while so I can get the money to do whatever. You know, you have to get smart about that, and that's not something I can obviously provide for you. It's not what you're asking me.
Understood.
But what you've figured out is how to work your day job and your creative stuff together. That's good. That's great.
I guess I'm going to start with a question about your process and then go into mine. When you write, do you write because you want to write the characters, or do you write because you want to work on a certain theme? Because I find in my work, I can write an entire draft very, very, as long as I want to, in a very short space of time. And then when I start rereading it, it kind of disappears into what I was trying to say. And I don't know if I can keep the longest version of it, because it feels like it's unnecessary.
Writing and rewriting.
Yes.
And you write your first draft, and you can just be like, it goes, go.
I can, yeah.
It's fine. Go and get it done, right?
And then I read it. And I find what I seem to be trying to say, or what these people are trying to say. And then I never feel confident enough to rework it, because I feel like I've said it in that way, and I don't know how to make the characters still natural or still work within this world while not just completely actively pursuing this idea. So I don't quite know how else to put it.
Yeah. No, I understand. It was hard for me to show you focus and hear you. It sounds like you write first from like character. Are you clear about what they're doing, where they're going, what their story is, sort of, right? And then you pull back and say, okay, now I want to get to the theme. Does that sound like I'm on the track? I want to get to the theme, or what the thing is really about, kind of thing. And so I do a lot of cutting, a lot of rewriting along those lines. And
I feel like I lose those characters.
You lose the characters when you pick up the threads of the theme.
Yeah.
That's interesting. It's funny. I rarely write theme. I mostly write just story, if you will, which is maybe a in-between. Yeah. So I don't like have pages and pages and pages of character, what they call bio. You know, as some writers, they write 80 pages of character bio. I know everything about my character, they say. But none of it's in the play. Amazing. You know? Or they say, I know the theme, I've done all the research on the theme. And it just sounds like the play or the movie sounds like someone's shaking their fist at you. So I kind of drop down in the middle and write about story. And so I say, what is the story that I'm telling? Once upon a time, there was. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
Which is kind of a combination of character and theme. But more, I can tell you what the character's doing, but I rarely can tell you like the theme, you know, the meaning, or the what I'm trying to say. I really don't get into that too much when I'm writing. So if you're cutting along those lines, think of what's the story? Because the story is where character meets theme, I would think. That's how I'm thinking of it right now. You see, it's the intersection of character biography and what you want to say.
Okay.
So that's where they come together. That's the crossroads. And that's what you want to write from that point. What's the story? So you walk around saying, what's the story? What is my character doing in every scene? How am I following him or her?
Right.
Did you feel like you were done?
I thought I was.
Right. What's your name?
Brandeis.
Yeah, oh, you've been here before. I remember your name. Yeah. Yeah, you thought you were. Yeah, well, that's the tricky thing. How do you know when you're done? Brandeis wants to know, how do you know when you're done? And a lot of times you think you're done because you think you're done, and then someone comes along, a leprechaun leaps out of the wood and says, Brandeis, you did nice. Your Transylvanian accent. That's very bad. So the thing about being done is it's a skill that you develop over time with the relationship with your work. And I say, if you feel like you're down, you're done. If someone comes along that you really care about and whose opinion you really value and says, you need more here, you might consider it. If you sit down and bang your head against the wall and nothing comes, then you're done for now. And I'd say shoot it. You know, you want to shoot a scene or, you know, stage something or whatever, then put it up as it is. And maybe the rest will come later. Okay, but if you're feeling like you're done, then you're done. Okay, you can always add more to it in the future. Okay?
So I think one of the problems I've discovered with me just in the process of writing a lot over this last year is that I have too much attachment to my work. I think there has to be a certain level of detachment in order for you to move forward with the editing process and all that, and not feeling like the words on the page are you, are a reflection of who you are. And I'm just getting to the point where I can do that. And it stymies me, still in screenwriting, but not as bad as I was having before. But it's like I'll sit and I'll stare at the blank page, and I'll, you know, I hear your voice in my head saying it's okay to write a fucked up first draft, and then I just go ahead and do it. But it's really a process. So if you could talk a little bit about, because I know just from watching you, like, I think you have a good, healthy level of detachment from what you write. Like, I don't think you find a lot of asset. You know, I don't think it means, not that it's meaningless, but I think, you know, it's not the attachment that I have, that I feel I have to my work. How does that come?
I think Stacey's talking about detachment and how you write something and you're attached to it, and how then it's hard to edit. You know, it's difficult to do a rewrite because you're really attached to what you've written, and that's a really a good thing to think about and talk about. Again, it's a practice thing. Can you hear me okay? It's a practice thing. So when you write something, you talked about, there's someone here the other week who put it in a drawer, let it cool off. Hemingway did that. Put it in a drawer, let it cool off, like a pie, you know, or a cake. Let it cool down so you get some distance from it, so you can pick it up and read it as if someone else wrote it. But it's also a practice. It's a skill set. It's a craft thing. You know what I mean? How do you know what you're done? How do you know what to cut? And you know, I mean, it's a practice thing. So you just have to keep working on that and knowing that you might be a little overly holding on to things and just like, hey, okay, I'm holding this a little too tightly, you know? And just know that and just keep thinking, okay, I'm gonna rewrite it, I'm gonna let it go. And think of when you cut things, you know, they fall to the ground and they grow into something else, if they should. They do. Yeah, they're not dead. You know what I mean? They're not dead. They're just, they're like cuttings. They're like think of it as gardening. Yeah. Rather than sort of like, I don't know what, a limb. You know, think of it as gardening, and that you're cutting, they're cuttings, actually. You know, like you're have cuttings in your garden.
Okay. That's good.
Destiny, I've got several questions, but this one is, how do you let go of narrative writing and start grouping together with descriptive writing as for scripts and live action scenes?
Buy, you know, fancy knockoff bags from the West African vendor on the street. That's a character. Oh, the girl who likes, you know, whatever your characters are. And start thinking of what story they're going to be in. What is their story? Who are your characters and what is their story? And I think if you're journaling, you start seeing themes, I mean, seeing recurring things that you're writing about. And that's a good way. But you could, if you want to, next week, text with tweet us back and explain to us what narrative writing is according to you. Because I'm not really sure about that. So tweet us back if you want to be there.
It's right. Tricky.
Well, it's always, but it's going to be, when you're in the profession, there are going to be deadlines.
Yeah.
So that's probably why they give you deadlines in school. They're preparing you for the real and the outside. You're locked up and they're preparing you for the outside. So you might as well develop a skill now of being able to put it away and maybe put it, imagine going into like the deep freeze. You know, it's not just in a drawer, it's in work on something else or work on nothing. And then come back to it. You know, try different ways of reading it, maybe aloud, maybe, you know, different ways of looking at it, just sort of make you feel like, yeah, I can cut stuff.
Something that I find helpful, because you were talking about attachment, is it's really simple. I keep a version of all my drafts, so when I print out the next one, I don't care if, like, I might be attached to something because it's so meaningful, but it doesn't matter because I know that it's there. Like, I can always go back to it.
Yeah,
so I keep and I didn't used to do that, and then I couldn't edit as much. And now I just keep every draft
because
you
know
can.
There's something.
Yeah, it's like, because that pearl that I wrote, I will need in some way. I usually don't, but I know it's there. It's accessible, so then I can work everything else out. That's helpful. Yeah, that's smart. If you don't have time.
No, true. Yeah. That's actually a good idea.
That's helped me write.
Hi. Is there a general piece of advice that you maybe developed yourself or maybe a mentor of yours has given you way back when, that when you come up against a problem or you run up against the wall, you repeat it to yourself and it keeps you going? Do you have anything like that?
Like a mantra?
Yeah, or something like, it'll be okay, it's just, I can throw away your first draft or something
good.
Like, yeah.
No, the best ones are the ones that come from
you.
It'll be okay. That's just the first draft. That's a good one. Keep going. That's a good one. Sit down and keep going. That's a good one. Put the time in. That's a good one.
Yeah.
Just sit down and put the time in. That's a good one. See, here's some guys working. He's in charge of the whole universe. There he is. He's in charge of the universe. But those kinds of things. You know, just keep going. Put the time in. A lot of times you think, why are I seeing the results I want? We haven't put the time in. You know, we haven't put in the whatever 2 hours a day or 30 minutes a day.
I put the worrying in, but not the doing.
She puts the worrying in, but not the doing. Right. The worrying is you get a lot of worry. Yeah, you get more worry.
And you get no pages.
No worry. Yeah, lots of worry, no pages. Right. Lots of worry.
They said Chuck that
Palinup, who wrote Fight Club, wrote it a sentence at a time as he worked in a gas station. Like, he just kind of, whenever he would get a break, he would just kind of creep it in and write it. And that taught me how to steal, just steal time, right?
Right.
Even when I, from myself often.
Right.
So,
work a sentence at a time, a line at a time. Yeah. So, anything you can think of is just as important as what I might tell you in terms of what you need to keep going. Because you have your own set of circumstances in your own life. You know what you're up against every day, any way that I know. And those kinds of things that come to you are the most valuable thing. The small, still voice within you, right? Not within me. It's within you. That's why we're talking about you. The small, still voice within. That's what has a lot of your knowledge that you're going to find. So keep going. Keep showing up.